He was a great humanitarian, and he tried to hide it. Generally, people didn't understand that part of it then, the great depth of soul and heart that he felt. And it all comes through.
Gould was news, different with his chair, his unpretentious ways. His music was discussable, and he was unpredictable, this friendly, memorable Canadian.
Nothing mattered except the kind of music making you were hearing, and that is what I always heard from Glenn Gould, without exception.
By now, his name was linked the world over with Sebastian Bach, the greatest of all architects of sound. On tour, on records, and in Canada on television, it was Bach, again and again. Of all Glenn's tours, the visit in 1957 to the Soviet Union was especially memorable for him, and it's still remembered there. He was the first North American artist to visit, with his manager, Walter Homburger.
We were showered with flowers. I mean, not only cut flowers, but huge plants. And when we finally got back into the limousine, the whole car was full of these plants. And I said to Glenn, I think we're driving to our own funeral at this point. The plants were actually planted in the garden of the embassy in the end. But Glenn got a tremendous thrill out of that.
I'm a very bad tourist. You know, I tend to get like a horse with blinders on when I'm in places where I'm supposed to admire because of their scenic beauty. In fact, I really did a bit of sightseeing there because that was like so much like being on the other side of the moon that not to take advantage of it would have been a catastrophe.
He gave lectures too, in Russian, in English, on contemporary music. His tours were a success wherever he went. Come back, they said, please come back. Glenn's appeal was universal. He touched people's minds and stirred their feelings.
There was a kind of intensity about his playing. It's a particular kind of musical intellect. It is a particular kind of awareness of the shape and meaning of the music, both structurally and emotionally, and the purpose of every note's being there. I don't think the intellect ever overrode his sense of the emotional message.
But he didn't like concertizing, the aggressive competition again, and playing for mob reactions, the herd response.
It seems to me that an audience is there for only one purpose, and that is to listen. They are not there to respond. They are not there to applaud. You have to consider them individually, not for their mass response. It is just as if you were playing for a few friends who unfortunately got too many, you know?
Recordings and the intimacy of television were his ideal for making music, for you, the listener, with friends like Yehudi Menuhin. And they were particular friends. Glenn Gould rarely practiced. A waste of time, he thought. He didn't have to.
He said, if I practice, I lose my spontaneity. If he shook hands with someone, it really did affect his fingers. He really did have to practice. And he did soak his hands in hot water. And he did wear gloves. But it was all a shortcut to being able to sit down and play the piano instantly without any warming up whatsoever.
Once, John Roberts saw him sight-read the Greig concerto.
Well, with his eyes glued to the score, never looking once at his hands, he commenced, and it was just astounding. Sounded like Horowitz. Very brilliant, and a tremendous speed, incredible speed. I thought he'll never be able to keep this up. Well, when he came to the cadenza of the first movement, which is extremely difficult, there are arpeggiated sections where you really have to think very carefully what you're doing. Otherwise, it's really quite hard not to play wrong notes. And I thought, he's just got to come unstuck. Just got to. Not a bit of it. It was astounding. He came to the last movement. He took it at a most incredible speed. Again, I thought, how can he keep this up? He sailed through the work, gave absolutely the most remarkable performance of it. He played all the orchestral parts whenever he could, sang those which he couldn't quite make, and at the end, shut the score and said, it's not for me. I asked him at the end of the Greig, Glenn, don't you find anything difficult? And he said, well, not really. I try mainly not to look at the battlefield, meaning the keyboard. I think it worried him that he really didn't know how he produced such results. I mean, from a technical point of view. He said to me, for instance, I could never teach. He didn't ever want to think analytically about pianistic things. As long as he didn't know it was difficult, it wasn't difficult. He loathed pianistic talk. That is how one actually did things with fingers and hands. All he knew was that he could do it.
His music was European, but Glenn was North American, and his imagination was Canadian. Robert Fulford.
There was an element of his work that was distinctly Canadian, I think, and that was the freedom, the openness, the sense of possibility that was natural to him. It wasn't something he had to fight for. He didn't have to fight back layers of prejudice in himself. He didn't have to keep pushing through dead ideas. It was there immediately, almost as if it was his birthright, a sense of how grand and open the future was, and how many things could be changed and how things could be done differently.
Differently. He could work differently. Still a superstar and writer, and perhaps one day, perhaps when he was 50, a recording conductor. As he had been many years before on CBC television for Maureen Forrester.
He felt very deeply about that piece of music. He'd look at you and smile. You realize it was going well.
After 9 years on the international circuit, playing what he called a spectator sport, he simply dropped out, age 32, to live a creative life his way. His manager, Walter Homburger, understood.
Most others thought maybe he'll have a hiatus of several years and then decide he misses it too much, and I said, don't count on it. Once Glenn has made up his mind, he usually, having known him, sticks to it.
Applause, the world's glories, didn't mean much to him, pilgrim that he was. He won many honors. They were appreciated. But somehow, Bruno Mont-Saint-Jean produced several TV programs with Glenn Gould.
He did not want any kind of applause. He did not want reactions. But he did want communication. He did want give and take. He did want people to react without that kind of noisy reaction, but to share what he was doing. I've never seen him more happy than in the studio, in the company of people, provided they shared, you know, the enthusiasm in his way towards creation. I've had more interesting comments on Glenn Gould from non-musicians than from musicians, because I think that Glenn was definitely a threat to the musical profession. You know, everything that was established, that was routine, that was taken for granted in music, that is taken for granted in the world of music, has been shattered by Glenn's thought. So that, you know, as a man, as a living man, he was a threat to the musical profession. He was a threat to the competitive aspect of music making. He was the threat to the power grabbing that a lot of interpreters are about.